I'm here with Farhad Hafezi. Farhad, I'm happy to speak with you. We're talking off camera about a study in which you're engaged, and I was astounded by, you know, some of the findings that you mentioned. But before we get to the exciting part, the finding will be the dessert of this conversation. I want to talk about what the study is, what its purpose is, and what the methodology is. So let me get you to sort of lay that out for me.
With pleasure, Josh. We were interested in learning more about the real prevalence of keratoconus. And the main reason is, now that we have a technology at hand, cross-linking, to stop the disease at early stages, we need to learn more about when does the disease occur and how many people are really affected. And when I published all this data over the cross-linking data over the past 10, 15 years, I very often cited a landmark study published by Kennedy and colleagues in 1986 stating that keratoconus is a rare disease, 1 in 2,000 people. And to be honest, it's only been a few years that I started reading this entire paper from 1986 to better understand what happened there. And I realized then that the paper we all cite for keratoconus prevalence had studied a Minnesota population between the 1940s and early 1980s with technology that is not really up to date anymore. They used keratometry mirrors and irregular light reflexes, what we had at hand in the 1940s, 50s, and 60s. And based on these findings was established a number that is still in the literature up to this day. And so we said, okay, with everything we now have at hand, using modern Chimeplug imaging technology, what is the real prevalence? And we started the pilot study in Riyadh, and we put a pentachem into the emergency room of a pediatric hospital that has no ophthalmological clinic. And we started screening children, adolescents, and young adults, so from 6 to 21 years, with a short questionnaire, excluding any ophthalmological disease. And we looked at the prevalence as seen in the topography. Two masked examiners, both experienced corneal surgeons, looked at all these U12 files. And we were very surprised by the outcome because, first of all, these two examiners had an almost 100% concordance in how they judged the cones or the corneas. We did three classifications. Either the cornea is normal, it is borderline, or distant keratoconus. We excluded everything that is borderline. We only focused on the distant keratoconus, and the prevalence was 1 in 21.
1 in 21 people?
Yeah.
That is a huge number.
It's a huge number. Well, we knew already from more recent studies that the number must be higher in the Middle East. There are many factors, including eye rubbing, allergy, geographical variations, but this was really an eye-opener. And so what we plan now is what we call the Light for Sight K-MAP study, which will try to map the global prevalence of keratoconus. Basically, we take the study protocol from this pilot study and multiply it on 4 continents. We have 10 sites on board now in 4 continents, and just managed to get a big Chinese site on board too. And we will do this now. We had 1,000 eyes in Riyadh, and we plan to have 10,000 plus eyes over the next 12 to 18 months. It's quite easy to collect these data because all we need are well-done pentachem measurements. That's quite easy to do. And so we get a better feeling about the distribution, the global distribution.
Well, it's really something, and certainly, I mean, I'm going to look forward to having this conversation with you once you have these data, and I'm not going to hold you to the answer of what I'm going to ask next, which is how specific do you think that this high incidence is to this population that was studied? And do you think that these high numbers are going to bear out in these other populations?
That is exactly why we do this study. I'm quite convinced that the Middle East will have the highest prevalence. And probably the further we go north, Norway, Sweden, Denmark will have a much lower prevalence, but I think still higher than 1 in 2,000. So we need to correct this old number.
A really, really, really interesting stuff. And it's relevant, very relevant, because of the therapies that we have now. I mean, had this study been done, you know, 15 years ago, it really, you won't mind my saying, it really wouldn't have mattered because there wasn't anything that we were going to do. intervene with these patients.
Exactly.
This is wonderful stuff. I'm looking forward to having the same conversation with you as the study progresses, so that we can see how this painting turns out.
Hopefully.
Yeah. Farhad, thank you very much for bringing this topic to us, and as always, for being so very generous with your time with us today.
Thank you, Josh.